this is going live on Facebook too, right?
It is. It is.
So Bobby's saying she's got nothing on Facebook Live right now. I don't know.
We just started.
Got it.
All right. So people should be, they're filtering in now on Facebook Live. We are seeing you here in Zoom. We were just having a few technical issues, which I'm sure you are all aware of. We're just waiting for one of our, the speaker of the hour, and I see her. So Tony Marie, if you can elevate Rachel to panelist so that we can actually see her on our screens. Awesome.
Hi.
Thank you all for your patience, for being with us. Rachel, thank you so much for being here, being patient and understanding with something that happens to me with every single event I try and do on Zoom, but we're gonna keep it moving. We are flexible, we are powerful women. Again, welcome to everyone who is joining us today on here in the Zoom room, and many, many more of you on Facebook Live. We are so excited to have you join us today for this Women in Film series, Conversations and Connections. This is where we feature conversations between phenomenally talented, incredibly accomplished female creatives about their visionary work. I'm Ebony Adams. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the manager of public programs here at Women in Film. A quick housekeeping note before I introduce our speakers. We will be taking your questions here in the Zoom room. So please use that Q&A button at the bottom of your Zoom screen to submit those questions to Rachel. I'm gonna be coming back at the end of it to pose those questions to her. So please don't wait. If you've got a question during the course of the conversation between Rachel and Melinda, please use that Q&A button to post those queries. And so now for our special guests. Film composer Rachel Portman is best known for her artful, award-winning film scores heard in more than 100 major motion pictures. She received an Oscar for her work on Douglas McGrath's 1996 adaptation of Jane Austen's Emma, and has collected other nominations for the Cider House Rules and Chocolat. Her music for the HBO television feature Bessie was honored with a Primetime Emmy Award. She was also the recipient of an OBE in 2010, the same year she was the first woman to win the Richard Kirk Award at the BMI Film and TV Awards. And now the reason we're here today. For years, Rachel has written scores deeply inspired by the natural world. Her first album, Ask the River from Node Records, is an album for solo piano, two pianos, violin and cello, and takes its starting point from the human experience and the earth. With this album, Portman gives personality and life to fleeting emotional moments and the elemental energy that is all around us. Joining Rachel to lead our conversation today is Melinda Newman, and she's gonna talk about Rachel's work, but Melinda herself is a fantastic journalist, and I'm so excited she is here to lead this conversation. She is Billboard's executive editor, West Coast and Nashville. You can see her cat popping up occasionally on the screen as an additional audience member.
Here we go again.
There you go. The cat does not want to miss it. No one wants to miss this. So after serving as Billboard's West Coast Bureau Chief from 1998 to 2006, Melinda became a top entertainment and culture freelance writer for more than a decade, contributing to the Washington Post, the Los Angeles Times, Rolling Stone, Christian Science Monitor, Forbes, Parade, Entrepreneur, Billboard, The Hollywood Report, Variety, and many other outlets. She's reported on issues from around the world, including Lebanon, Peru, and Poland. She returned to Billboard in 2017 as West Coast editor. And then in February 2019, she expanded her duties to include Nashville and has greatly increased Billboard's coverage of country music on both his pages and in Billboard.com. And finally, to kick off our talk, I want to introduce you to Tracy McKnight. Some of you have met her before at previous events. She is the dynamic, the phenomenal Women in Film board member, among other things, a few other things, some of which I will tell you about right now. She is a prolific and award-winning music supervisor, label co-founder, and former head of film music for Lionsgate. Her resume of over 150 films showcases a balance of studio films, acclaimed documentaries, and independent films. She co-runs Node Records, which released Ask the River, which we'll be talking about today. And it's a boutique soundtrack label. She's also, as I said, a just highly valued member of the board of directors, excuse me, here at Women in Film, and also a member of the TV Academy Music Peer Group Executive Committee, and serves as an advisor to the Sundance Film Festival, where she co-programs their prestigious annual concert, A Celebration of Music and Film. Everyone, I'm gonna turn off my camera so you can focus on these three amazing women who are with us today. And again, welcome to all to you and to them. And now I will turn it over.
Well, thanks, Tracy. Hi, everyone. I'm so happy to be here today as a proud member, board member of Women in Film, and also as the co-president of Node. And all I wanted to say was, I'm so grateful that Women in Film, I champion female composers and I chair the music committee. And I couldn't be more thrilled to be working with Rachel Portman on this beautiful album and being a part of her artistic journey. And I'm just so grateful that everybody tuned in today, and I'm gonna hand it over to Melinda to take the reins. So thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Tracy and Ebony. And Rachel, thank you so much. I know you did not plan an album for the coming pandemic, but I have found this album has given me incredible solace in just these anxious, anxiety-filled, troubling times. And it's just exquisite and so poignant. And I just personally, as a listener and as a fan, want to thank you. I've turned it on to so many people and said, just listen to this. It's going to make your corner of the world better. And so thank you so much for the album. And just before I get started, but I want to start with, why was the time right now to do this album? I mean, you first started professionally at 22 and haven't stopped. So why now?
I think it's been a long time brewing. I've had a sort of deep interest in the environment and our connection to the earth. So a deep and growing interest. And certainly in the last, 15 years probably, I've started writing sort of pieces outside film with an environmental theme, and often with text, so not so much. I've never sort of dedicated a sort of whole project like this to it. And so I started writing a couple of pieces, and then it grew into an album, really, which is how it came about. And it grew into a sort of body of work, which it was really focused in the last sort of 18 months. So it's interesting that it's come out now, because, I feel the world is we're beginning to pay attention to the world because we all have to be so still at the moment. And if we're lucky enough to be near a tree or to be near some grass or some, a wood or anything like that, I mean, well, I think everybody's so becoming so much more grateful to what we have around us in a way.
You mentioned that, like, for the last 15, 20 years, some of your work had focused on the environment. I want to talk specifically, you wrote The Water Diviner's Tale, which is an oratorio for a children's choir. You wrote Earth Song, which I think was based on a Nick Drake.
That's right.
Can you talk a little bit more about your progression? It sounds like it was a 15 to 20 year period leading up to this. Like, what provoked that interest at all?
Well, it's partly because I grew up in the countryside, and I sort of, in the last 15 years, I've started to spend a lot more time in the countryside, and I've been able to, and I realized how important it is to me. And, like any writer, you're kind of developing your voice, and you're developing what it is that you want to say and what you want to communicate. And my first love is writing music for film, and but I also love writing music for theatre or for musical or for opera, or so I like to expand. But then there's this whole feeling of needing to come home to what is really, really important to me, and I have to say, nature sort of gets bigger and bigger until I feel I really, really need to express that. So, which is why I sort of turn my attention and focus so much to this in a concentrated way. That's why.
The album opens with just this beautiful piece called Leaves and Trees. And I was reading that that's also the first piece that you composed for this project. Can you talk about how that was your gateway in and how that informed the rest of the project?
Yes. I mean, it's difficult. It's very, very hard to talk about music. Because music,
yes, it is
of itself. Do you know what I mean? But I was interested in looking up through the branches of a big tree with a lot of leaves that were new leaves, and how they played against each other in the light. And that's where the Leaves and Trees came to me. And I was also interested in which is unlike me normally, but in interleaving my hands as I was playing the music, so that the strands of the piano are all interleaved with each other. And so that it has a sort of, that, I mean, so that's how that piece came about. And from that, I knew that I thought, gosh, why would it be called Leaves and Trees? I mean, but I thought, gosh, I want to write a piece about a river now. And so it sort of, I began to expand out, and then some of the titles are more enigmatic, but that was the first piece. And so it has a deep connection for me to being immersed in nature, so that that you're part of it, so that we're not separate as human beings. It's not something that we forget about, and you know, we can be so much in our heads and so caught up with work and so, you know, deadlines and this busy world that we're in, but to actually, you know, let nature in, sort of like into our souls, if that's not too odd a thing to say, is it to me is really important, and it's a kind of a response to that.
It's just remarkable to me in that piece, you can almost see the leaves moving. Like there's the piece so beautifully captures a sense of movement, as I found a lot of these pieces did. Like you could imagine the river flowing, you know, on Ask a River and on Leaves and Trees. It's like, I can almost hear the wind coming through the trees. Just, you know, it just captures it so evocatively. I just thought it was beautiful. You talk about how you live outside, you live in the countryside. Were you going on walks and just being inspired, or were some of these pieces inspired by travels throughout the years, or was it really more immediate of what was immediately around you that was inspiring you?
Really much more immediate. It's about being really still in nature, actually. So that I'm still, if anything. And, you know, and if that means, you know, if that means sitting in the grasses for a long time and, you know, feeling what that is, that's what that is. I mean, I've been quite inspired by, in fact, one of the pieces, The Summer Day, is inspired by a Mary Oliver poem. I don't know if you're familiar with that. Yes. The poem.
Did you write it before she died or after she died?
Sorry,
did you write it before she died or after she died? It was already just a...
Oh, I wrote it. I wrote it. Because when did she die? She died...
It was last year.
I think I wrote it around the time that she died. It wasn't in response to her dying. I was really sad when she died. And, you know, there's a fantastic thing on YouTube of her actually reading it. It's just wonderful. But you know, those kind of questions that she poses, like, you know, who made the world? And I find very inspiring. And I feel that she's someone who, you know, really paid attention, was able to really pay attention to the living world around, the natural world around us. So she's been an inspiration to me. Anyway, she has.
When you're writing for film, you're clearly writing for something much bigger than yourself. You know, your music is in service of this bigger piece of art. What was it like to not have any constraints like that?
Well, it's harder. It's harder because it's like you don't have a friend there that you're not trying to sort of, you don't have an impetus to, you're sort of pulling these ideas up from yourself. Yeah. And then you're sort of, you have, and into that comes judgment about, you know, is this, you know, and often I'm working with really, really quite simple, deliberately simple ideas. And you know, how simple can they be? So all of that. And I think, like, I'm sure this is true of writing in any area of, I mean, it's certainly true when I do a film, is you have to lose yourself. That if you're thinking about stuff too much, it doesn't come. And it's when you go into that zone of stopping thinking, where you in a way you stand out of the way of yourself, that then ideas begin to flow. And then you think, okay, I'm beginning to work with something that feels more manageable. And I mean, I find that when I work on a film as well. You know, I stand outside and think about, oh God, what's the theme got to be? You know, I've got to come up with a theme or melody or a type of music or something. And again, that sort of searching that you do at the beginning of the film, and then at a certain point that falls away and you're just in it and you're writing it and you know it somehow. It's the same kind of thing with writing a piece that isn't with a film. It's just the drawing board stage is harder, I would say.
Because you don't have, you know, you don't have a script, you're not writing to picture. Though, did you bring any pictures into your studio while you were writing? Like you're talking about this lovely tree, you know, you're like, okay, now I want to write about the river. While you're actually writing, did you have any images physically that you were looking at, or were they just the ones in your mind?
Yes, I did. I mean, I took not a lot, but I took a few photos, particularly trees, actually. I mean, it's trees. Trees and trees and trees are sort of kind of what really sort of feed me, I think. And so I had some photos of some, you know, really beautiful bark on an oak tree. And I particularly love oak trees, actually. I did. But again, they're sort of there, and then it's sort of all in you. So yeah.
Did you? You know, again, when you're writing for film, very often you're writing for a specific character. Were you able to just transfer that and go, okay, now I'm writing for this oak tree or juniper, you know, or something? I'm thinking about, you know, some of the specific songs on there. Did the river become a character for you? Did the leaves and trees become a character for you in that way? Or am I thinking in a way that it doesn't translate?
I think as an initial starting point, and it's like, so, okay, what's the trigger to start writing this piece? What is it? And then, you know, and some pieces were like that, some pieces weren't, but there was a feeling, there was a sense that I wanted to convey, an essence of something. But then once I had the core idea, I was just working with the material and I wasn't still sort of like working with the character. I mean, it's really like having a piece of clay. Once you've got a piece of clay and you've got it and you're sort of molding it, you think, okay, so what can it be? And then one day, oops, it becomes something. And then you think, oh no, I really don't like that. So you chuck it away, which is what I did with Ask the River. Ask the River, I worked on for a long time. And then I thought, no, it can't be like that. And so I sort of put it right back to its basics and I built it up again. But I'd stopped thinking about, you know, that I was doing this river thing. I was then working with material.
You said it took about 18 months to write. Were you able to just exclusively work on this, or were you having to work on films and you'd have to stop and do a film and then go back to this?
Yes, I did work on other projects at the same time. I mean, I did a television animation, and I also did Earth Song, which was for a choral commission with the poet Nick Drake. But apart from that, I set aside the time to write this. So it was very immersive. Yeah.
I think I was astonished to read this, and I don't know why it astonished me so much, that this is the first project of yours that you're actually playing. You know, I was kind of like, wow, you haven't played on any of your scores before. So what was that like for you to be the artist, not just the composer?
Well, it was, you know, I'm quite a shy person when it comes to performing, which is why I haven't performed. And, you know, I've always thought, well, they're such brilliant, brilliant players in LA, New York and London and wherever I've recorded, actually, other places too. You know, they'll play it better than me, even though I had a very strong sense of how I wanted things to be played, because piano is my main instrument. But I'm not, and for years I've wanted to put myself step forward and perform. So this was a challenge for me, actually, to do that. But I'm so glad I did it, and it was one of my many sisters who persuaded me to do it, because I wasn't quite sure, and she said, Rach, you must, because you're the author. You're going to know how to play these pieces. You know, be lovely if other people play them too. You know, and I hope when they do, that's fantastic. But you know, it's like that whole thing of here's a song for you, doing it yourself. So actually, I took great pleasure in doing it, and I really love doing it, and I will do more. So it's good.
You know, as Ebony said, it's solo piano, two pianos, and then violinist Cleo Gould and cellist Caroline Dale. Can you talk about working with them? And did you intentionally only work with other women?
Oh, gosh, there's a thought.
I think you just answered my question.
there's a thought. Well, they were my natural choice of people to go to, and they, I have to say, you know, they are, you know, Caroline Dale, the cellist, who's one of the most amazing cellists around. I mean, they get it. They got it. Their intuition was just extraordinary and so tender, the way she played. And also Cleo Gould as well. I mean, I feel extremely fortunate to work with them. And I think their, you know, their sensibilities were, you know, very in tune with the material. And maybe, you know, the fact that we're all women had something to do with that. You know, I'm sure that's true, actually.
But was the intention always for it to be so spare? I mean, it is so lovely. And, you know, then just a violin will come in or a cello will come in. Did you ever think about orchestrating it more, or was it always the intention to keep it very small?
I mean, it's quite a reflective, intimate, you know, selection of pieces. And I always thought I wanted that. Also, I mean, for me, it originated as just piano. And, you know, when there are two pianos in there, I'm playing both pianos. I'm just playing over myself, interleaving things, which I did. But and it was only I became curious about, sort of certainly in Leaves and Trees, about, you know, gosh, how would it be if suddenly a cello came in, like, you know, halfway through this piece? And what that does, and it sort of kind of opens it up. And it's interesting, because the minute you add a string instrument to the piano, that draws most of the focus, even though the piano is often the bedrock of everything. So it's a mixture, and I just thought it's nice to vary it, and it can be anything, you know, you can do anything. But I still wanted to keep the album sort of chamber intimate.
It's so intimate. And I was reading, someone else was asking you about, they felt like there was a sense of melancholy in it. And I didn't get that at all, especially if you listen to something like Childhood, where there's the wonder of childhood, the magical feeling of childhood, just the lightness with which you're playing. Do you think people may misinterpret it because some of it's in minor keys? I didn't feel it was melancholic at all.
It's funny that you should say that, because I think I read that quite a few people have said to me since they don't find it melancholic at all. I mean, it's not, I don't find it melancholic. I find it reflective. And I'm certainly, you know, I mean, that's where those are the kind of tones that I love, and that I'm drawn to. So I'm just expressing the kind of music that I'm drawn to. But I don't, to me, it's not, I mean, I think perhaps there's one piece in there which is much loved, which is, I think is, I'm not sad, but perhaps more moving than, but to me, there is, it's no, I don't think melancholy is its nature at all.
I don't either. So when you write for film, you have a lot of people giving you feedback. You got a lot of people saying, yep, this is what we wanted, perfect. Or can you go a different direction? Did you have anyone doing that for you, or on this? Did you have like a trusted circle that you were like, can you give me some guidance, or were you the final judge on everything?
I was totally the final judge on everything. I mean, of course, you know, I did, you know, as I finished pieces to a trusted musical friend, you know, I would say, you know, what do you think of this? And I, you know, it's very nice to have, you know, someone to bounce ideas off, but, you know, really it was all up to me, and all shaped by me, everything, and sort of no editorial really at all, which is massive freedom and, you know, the opposite from film. Film, on the other hand, is, you know, especially some films are incredible the way, you know, it's like, can you do it again? Can you do it like this? Actually, can you do this bit like this? And, You know, there's this enormous, you know, you have to be very, very flexible and willing to just reshape your ideas again and again and again, and new ideas. And I mean, it's great and it's fun. And it's amazing how many different times you can score a scene in so many different ways, you know.
Did that process help you though? Are there things that you've picked up from scoring so many films and so much wonderful work that helped you when you went into this process that maybe took away some of the fear? Like, you know, you can't necessarily get it right the first time.
Yes, no, I'm sure it did. I'm sure it did. And I also think that, you know, even though the bulk of my writing work has been in film, you know, I think I've always been developing my own musical language. And so this is really an extension of that. So, you know, and there are particular films that I think I have a particular connection to that have sort of helped me develop my musical writing language as I've gone along. And, you know, they would be Cider House, they would be Never Let Me Go would be one of them. And sort of several others sort of along the way, even One Day and, you know, and probably Chocolat too, but and others, but ones that really, I think, yeah. So I mean, if that answers your question, yes.
Yes, yeah. Take us into Air Studios. So you recorded at Air, legendary, very legendary Air Studios. I'm sure you'd been there a number of times when your scores are being recorded, but what was it like? How long did it take to record? Who produced? Were Caroline and Cleo in with you? Like, what was that process like?
That process, yeah, in fact, actually, it was, some of it was recorded at Air, not all of it was, because some of it, the solo, some of it was recorded on my piano at home, which was very deeply wonderful for me, because my piano is my best friend.
This is your Bösendorfer?
Yes, it's my most lovely. Yes, it's my best friend in that sense. And I write, I spend so much time writing it. So it was writing on it. But Air, we did some of it at Air, where we had to be together. My studio isn't big enough to have for me to play live with them. So we put our tracks down separately, except for a couple of the tracks where I played with the violinist, which we did it Air, which was great. You know, Air is the most fabulous, fabulous studio. And, you know, it's an amazing facility. And you know, I feel for all these studios now, you know, with what's gonna happen. And, yeah. You know, they're desperately trying to figure out, you know, how they're gonna record and how, you know, I'm sort of, you know, the project I'm working on now, I may well be recording there. And, you know, we're figuring out, you know, how are we going to, you know, we're gonna have to have much, much more recording time and, you know, put down much fewer sort of sections at a time. It'll be interesting. And you know, a challenge for me, because I actually love, even though, you know, it doesn't often happen in film, but I love having orchestras play without clicks. So they're free to play to the picture with the conductor. But that really won't be possible. If everyone's
not for a while.
Not for a while, no. No, they'll all have clicks.
Yeah, I know we're talking mainly about the album, but can you talk a little bit more about that? As, you know, Billboard, we've been covering every aspect of it, and we've talked about studios and, you know, and this kind of aspect, but do you have any sense of when you think you'd be able to get back in the studio? It sounds like you guys are trying to figure it out now.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard because, you know, I was just talking about it today. You know, we're thinking like, well, you know, we are on the schedule of the film that I'm working on, we're supposed to be recording at the end of July. And yet it's sort of like a chicken and egg. There's a little bit more additional shooting that needs to happen because the film is almost right. Shot. They're like, there are a few days left, and then, you know, are we going to commit to booking a studio when we don't really know quite what you know the lockdown situation is here in London? Well, or what this was going to be in London. I'm not in London right now, but we don't quite know how it's going to be in England. So, you know, everything's a bit tentative. We know more and more with each week that goes past, but I foresee it'll come from the studio. The studio will say, right, we have to stick to these dates, and then we can say, okay, so we've got to do it like this. Then we can figure it out. But you would have dates, and you'd be able to budget. You'd be able to, I've got a budget. I've got two budgets, actually, two scenarios. One wildly out of date one, which was if everything was normal, which we did about sort of 6 weeks ago, thinking it might be normal by then, who knows? And now one with prolonged sort of, several recording sessions and long, long mixing, and everything's going to be, studio time's going to be much more expensive.
Yes. And a much more protracted process.
Yeah.
And have on top of each other.
Yeah.
Record things separately. How do you want people to feel after they finish listening to this album?
Oh my goodness. That's a very interesting question. How do I want them to feel? Oh, I just hope they like it. I mean, I just hope that they, you know, if they're listening in a place where they're not in nature, that they can be transported to a place where they are in nature. And I hope they feel still, and I hope they feel a sense of calm, I suppose.
Again, which we need now more than ever, you know, again, it totally brought that to me. I sent it, my sister was having a bad day yesterday, and I was like, you just need to stop and listen to this. And she did, she like texted me. She's 3,000 miles away. She texted me later and she was like, thank you. That was like a gift to me. Aww. To just make me be still and listen.
Oh, so, that's really lovely. Really lovely.
That's definitely, you know, what it's doing. I am going to turn it back over to Ebony because I can see there's a lot of questions in here. Rachel, thank you very, very much. Thank you for this album. It's to borrow a title, it's a gift.
Thank you so much.
One of the songs. So thank you.
It is a gift. Melinda, thank you so much for all of that amazing conversation. I was listening rapt because this is, you know, film composition is a film that, you know, it's very opaque to me, as I'm sure it is to a lot of the people who are watching. So getting a peek into the process is fascinating. But like you, my reaction to this album, Ask the River, was, wow, this is a real balm. You know, this is something that I needed right now. And so I thank you, Rachel, for that. So let's take some audience questions if you have a few more minutes to do that. I'm gonna be looking at a couple of different screens because we are hosting here in Zoom, we're hosting on Facebook Live. So I'm getting questions from like four different avenues. So anyone watching, excuse my shifty eyes, it's because I'm trying to get to all of your questions. So this first one is from Miriam. She says, how much interaction do you have with producers and directors, to interact with, to figure out how to bring their vision to life, but keeping, you know, your art and your vision and your skills kind of at the forefront so that you're not an automaton, you're not a machine, a composition machine. So, you know, how much interaction do you have with them?
It really varies from film to film. I am, usually a lot, and it's mostly with the director, less with the producers, unless the producers are very actively creatively involved in the making of the film. But I would say it's mostly with the director, and, you know, some directors really, really know what they want and they're very prescriptive, and other directors don't really know and they're like, oh no, that's great. Thank you. That's great what you just done. In terms of holding on to what I think, it's a mixed feeling. I mean, I feel, you know, ultimately I'm collaborating on a project with a lot of people with a shared vision, but it's not my film. So, you know, I need to be flexible. I need to, I need to listen and change things when needed. But at the same time, I always stay true to, or try to stay true to what it is that I want to write. That answers your question. But you know, the main thing is that every single film is different, you know, mm-hmm. and each one has its own story and, you know, its own sort of vibe and that, you know, like all the different people who are working on it, like any film, you know, it's each one is, has a different color.
Sort of along those lines, each film having a different color, and then maybe expanding that out to kind of genre considerations or period considerations. Carol wants to know, or she says, two of my favorite scores are for Belle and Duchess. And she wants to know about your process for composing for period films specifically, because to her, it seems as if these scores are very sensitive to the characters, that there's something perhaps being done a little bit differently with the music in those films, as opposed to maybe things that are set in a more contemporary period. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, both those films are driven by female protagonists. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think, you know, they're both very beautiful films as well. And I had a strong connection to them. The fact that they were period is it's interesting that, because it's sort of like, it is a genre. And, you know, and I know that there are no rules anymore about how you would score, you know, a film that is a period film. And, you know, for me, I guess it's just intuitive to me how I would score both of those films. And, you know, they needed, I haven't used period music in them. So it's not music of the period, but it just feels right to me to score them like that. And that's how I approach everything. It's sort of not very technical, but it's just, I was moved by both those stories. And I think perhaps you're responding to that. And they both, and you know, there was room for real melody in them, and I love writing melodies. Mm. You know, so perhaps I wouldn't use guitars, you know. I mean, I might one day in a period film, but I haven't yet, because a guitar feels too modern, and I wouldn't perhaps use, electronica in the same way, you know, that I might in another film. Good question.
Elena says, your music shows balance, knowledge, grace, and elegance all around, and so does your career as a public figure. She wants to know, do you have any suggestions for how to better navigate the industry for a woman composer who's 48 years old, but still has the goal? You know, she's still young. She wants to make it to the next step from additional writer to lead composer. Do you have any suggestions for someone in that position?
Yeah, well, yes. Gosh, I mean, I think what you say about, you know, being determined is the biggest key that you can have, is not giving up and being, you know, putting yourself, doing as much as you can. And, you know, the doors do open, they do. And it has a lot to do with being in the right place at the right time. And, you know, but, you know, for me, it has always been, you know, working with somebody who then goes on to make something. So working on something small and then going with that person. So it's always been worth it to me to work on smaller projects where I am the main composer, if that might mean that, you know, then it happened to me with my first film coming to LA. I worked on a smaller project with Biban Kidron, the director, and she was amazing. She fought for me to go with her, you know, to the studio where I did my first studio film. So, and I think determination is what's it. And also, you know, if you have the desire, you need to be out there, and there is a way. Is all I can say. And keep going at it.
Awesome. Kind of a technical question from Lindsay. She wants to know if you have a favorite scoring stage. She clarified, because I thought she meant stage in, you know, the process of scoring, but she's talking about like the actual physical spaces. She says there's very few of these spaces left anymore, like the actual physical place where you record with like the full orchestra, etc. Is there a favorite venue of yours that you like to be in?
I think I would have to say Air Studios in London. I mean, it's the most beautiful, beautiful converted big church, and it has such a lush acoustic, and and space, and it's just exciting. It's always really exciting to go there. I love Abbey Road too, but I think the sound in Air for me is more, you know, even more wonderful, I would say.
I think we've got two more questions, and then you have graciously agreed to give us a live performance. So Siobhan asks about, you know, how you start immersing yourself in the feel of a film, because she's read in other interviews how male filmmakers sometimes question your ability to evoke like a suitably masculine energy for the film. And so she's asking about like how you start immersing yourself, you know, coming to understand what a director means sometimes by that kind of terminology so that you can then begin your work.
Yes, I mean, I suppose, I mean, what springs to mind there is where that came up was in a film I did about 4 or 5 years ago called Race, which was about Jesse Owens, the Olympic runner. And the director, you know, he wanted to, he said, you know, that the music needed to have a real male testosterone feeling to it. And he challenged me on that. And he said, can you do that? And I said, yes, just yes. Like, I mean, why would, who knows who's writing a piece of music, you know, who, you know, what sex they are. You just, it's anyway. And it was quite interesting. So I then took that and thought, well, what does he mean by that? Mm-hmm. You know, musically, what, you know, what is the stereotypical version of that? And I wrote the score accordingly. I put a lot of big drums in there, and it was quite sort of boomy, and you know, quite it was sort of quite big and brash, and it seemed to do with the, you know, what he wanted. So I mean, it's, yeah, I mean, the one of the big things about being a composer of music for film is the psychology of what's going on in you know, what you're being asked to do. And you know, you're having to attune to the film, but you're also having to take in a whole lot of information from the director about what they want, and actually read who they are. So, you know, they can be telling you one thing, but actually giving you very false direction. I've had that many times with directors who think they know what they want. And so you become a mind reader, and you know, it's fascinating in that sense. I mean, I'm fascinated in that, you know, and, you know, you sometimes get it wrong. And I go down blind alleys because, you know, someone has told me for ages that that, you know, the theme that they want has to be happy. It has to be. So I'm thinking, okay, it has to be in a major key. It's got to be in a major key. That's what they want. They want major. And then I find out that for them, happy is in a minor key. Mm. I've lost half my writing time going down the blind alley, which is stressful. So,
yeah. Okay, so before we turn to this performance, I do want to just let you know that we have been getting so many great comments from fans of your work and film, fans of this new album. I particularly want to shout out Adele, who says that she's just absolutely loving this interview. She's a 22-year-old film composer, and just thanks you so much for being here. So I would love to turn it over to you. Again, we are so delighted, not just to learn about your career as a film composer, but to talk specifically about this album. And so thank you for sharing this with us. And now I will turn it over to you.
Okay, thank you so much for having me as well. So I'm going to play this. I'm hoping it's getting a bit dark. I mean, I'm wondering I'm going to turn on a light. It's sort of like 9 o'clock at night here in England. So hang on a minute.
Okay. This is what I love about Women in Film events. Y'all know we keep it casual and informal. We're invited into people's homes, and this is what happens. You see their art. Sometimes you see their cat. Sometimes you get a live performance from an Academy Award-winning film composer. You never know what you're going to get with us.
Okay. Okay, so I'm going to play a gift. And this is just for solo piano. Okay. Right. Thank you.
That was amazing. And that was Rachel Portman. Rachel, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for being here with us today. This was absolutely wonderful. I appreciate your being here late in the evening for you, early in the day for us, but this was absolutely phenomenal. I wish you all the success for Ask the River. I, like Melinda, have been telling everyone about it. And I just, if you're in this room, you've listened to this interview today and you have not yet checked out the album, you owe it to yourself. It's gonna be good for you, trust me on that. So Rachel, thank you so much for everything. Thank you to everyone who joined us today, and we will see you at the next Conversations and Connections. Goodbye, everybody.